the name of the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Praise God. Give the Lord a big hand this morning. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Thank you. Praise God. Thank you, Mike and worship team and the ladies of, what is it?
The ladies.
The ladies. Praise the Lord. That's good. That's way too much for me. Praise the Lord. Amen. Praise the Lord. God bless everybody. Hallelujah. I was kind of putting some pressure on Mike here this morning because we're trying to do a few things differently, and one of them is I'd like to start church at 10 o'clock, like it says, praise the Lord. And if we don't do that, people have a tendency to think, well, you know, 10:15 is when we start, so we just come at 10:15. And, you know, I don't mind people coming late, but it doesn't mean church should start late just because people come late, all right? And it might be an inspiration to some to get here on time. Hallelujah. I'm just sounding ugly as all get out right now. But anyway, I'm speaking in terms of visitors more than anything else. For those of us that are, you know, here all the time, no big deal. We kind of have a laid-back attitude about it. We all know one another, and so it's kind of fine. But if you have visitors, they come and they expect church to start at 10 o'clock because that's when they got here. That's what the sign said. That's what somebody told them, and so that's the way it ought to be. Now, before I get into anything else, last week was a great service. We had a good time. The Lord blessed. But at the same time, it struck me that, you know, we talk about not wanting to be religious. And by that, I don't mean that everything religious is a bad thing. It's just that it locks you into stuff that isn't necessarily what you want to do. So we've had a tendency and tried to, from the very beginning, to do things a little differently than the typical mainline church. Not just to be different, but because we want people to feel connected, empowered, involved. But over time, our uniqueness just became another ritual to where, you know, I mean, just because it's new one day doesn't make it new forever. At some point, it becomes old, too. And you just get into a rut of doing everything the same way. And I noticed that last Sunday because we had visitors, and I'm assuming they're not all saved. And all I could think about through the entire service was give them an opportunity to accept Christ, to make some kind of a commitment to the Lord, or to make some sort of experiential contact with God. So all I was doing was trying to get from one stage of the service to the next. You know what I'm saying? Because that's what I told Mike and Michael, I think I'll say Michael is Michael Gerlach, and Mike is, well, he's Mike, praise the Lord. But I was talking to them Wednesday night, and I said, you know, I was so tense about this. I mean, that's what I wanted to do. I just wanted to get to that.
Yeah.
But because we have such a, we might as well have a program saying this is what we do. Even though it's unusual for people who don't come to this church, it's become just a routine for us to where we know what's coming next. We know what's after that. We know what's after that. And so if you're in one, let me say it this way, season, to be spiritual here, of the service, and that's not necessarily your cup of tea, then you're just waiting for the next one. You're really not involved or hooked up to what's going on at the moment. You're just waiting to move on to the next part of it, the part that you like. You know what I'm saying? Amen. So I think that all that we do is important, but I think when we do it in rote, when we just do it all the time the same way, it becomes boring. And it becomes just weird. It just becomes religious. It just becomes another ritual. So I'd like us to just, let's try to be fresh. We may continue to do the same things. We may leave some stuff out one service, add some stuff the next. However, you know, over the week's time that we interact, you know, with one another on Wednesday night and different things that are going on, we'll plug something in that we don't always do. We need to take something else out that we have been doing all the time and just have a, so that everybody doesn't come waiting for the next thing. So we come and we just do it, and we'll just mix it up.
Yes.
Now, just change for the sake of change isn't what I'm really after. I'm just trying to keep it fresh. I'm just trying to make it so everybody doesn't know what's going to happen from one minute to the next. And by that, it may make us, I'm hoping, this is what I felt during the service last week, I'm hoping that it'll make us more aware of the circumstances that we're in. Because it isn't always just us. And if we have people, and whether we know that they're unsaved or we just think they might be unsaved or whatever the situation is, we need to be sensitive to that. That should be our goal for that service, not to just make sure we get through all of our stuff, but let's get to that person with Christ and give them an opportunity to have this connection, to have this opportunity. Because, I mean, you don't know if you're ever going to see him again. Especially on Easter and Christmas, people come. That's they're coming because somebody invited them. It's Easter, mm-hmm. And they're at their house for lunch, and they don't want to, or dinner, and they don't want to embarrass them. So they say, "Sure, I'll go." Yep. They may not be in church again for another year. So this is an opportunity that we need to take advantage of because that's what the Lord wants us to do. Okay, so that's what we're talking about. So if you come in and we're doing worship at the end and prayer at the beginning, or prayer in the middle and prayer at the and worship at the end, or and everything looks like it's different, it's because it is, and that's just our intent, is to try to make it that way so we're not so rigid in the way that we do things that we can't change, that we can't just allow opportunities for the Lord to move. So, you know, we've been talking about 2017 being a special time. A time of change, a time of new things and so forth. Well, I mean, the more I thought about it, we've heard it prophesied, different ones. We've heard it acknowledged by others, including myself, believing that that's the case, because God's always wanting to do a new thing. And then we continue doing the old thing. Yeah. You got to wonder, you know, if we're just prophesying to the wind. Right. You know, if we're not willing to be moved or to make changes, then why would we think God's going to do something different if we aren't? Because the truth is, if God does anything different, he's going to have to do it through us. That's his chosen method of doing things. So praise the Lord. So that's all I really have to say this morning about that, other than I want to thank Suzanne and Sarah for doing a great job from all that I heard with the women's conference. Sounded like it was a real success and a great platform or foundation to build on for next year and for years to come. So praise the Lord. God bless them. And let's give the Lord a hand clap for that. Okay, praise the Lord. Let's stand for just a moment. And I only want to take up an offering this morning, just the routine offering. And I'm just going to preface it by saying this. The church needs money to operate. We're not broke. I'm not begging. I'm not pleading. It's no different than it's ever been. It's what it always is. I'm just saying that's the way the reality of life is. Yep. Amen. So we got to have money to operate. And I think it's kind of cool because God needs faith in order to operate. Now, I'm grateful to this church because this church is a giving church. For as small as it is, you'd be amazed at what God does through people. And I'm amazed every week, every month, every year. So I'm not saying, come on, help us, we're starving. That's not what I'm saying. Nothing's changed. Everything's cool. I'm just saying the reality is churches don't exist without finances. They can't. It's like anything else. And God can't move without faith. So here's an opportunity this morning to take care of two issues at once. You can step out in faith. I'm not saying huge offer. I'm just saying just whatever you would normally give, but give it in faith. Yes, that's what I'm saying. Just give it in faith. That honors God, and it does. It also serves the purpose for which it's given. Amen? Amen. Yes. Praise the Lord. So, Roberto, if you and Toby would come over, since you're right here in the front row, I'll take advantage of you guys. So, Father, I just ask you to bless your people, bless the seed that they sow. You said that you'd give seed to the sower and bread to eat and multiply the seed sown. So, Father, I'm just holding you to your word. And you said if we would pray your word, we'd know that you'd hear us and that we'd receive our petition. So I'm asking you to bless your people. Bless them for their faithfulness. Bless them for their support of the church. And most importantly, Lord, bless them for trusting you, because you are the source of all things. So I ask you to bless this offering now, and everyone who gives, and those who are unable to give, Lord, bless them as well, that they may have seed to sow. In Jesus' name. God bless you as you give. Praise the Lord. Go ahead, guys. Hallelujah. Please be seated. In fact, if you've already done your thing, take a minute, shake hands with somebody, say hi if you didn't get a chance to speak to them before the service. Do it now. Sunday school kids may be dismissed to go downstairs. Love you.
Love you.
Okay, praise the Lord, everybody. If you can, break away from your new best friend. Praise God. Again, I want to thank everybody for being here this morning and appreciate you coming to worship the Lord. So we're going to go to the Word of God now, and I want to begin in Deuteronomy chapter 4 and verse 2. Deuteronomy 4 and verse 2. Now, I don't know what we're going to do next week, but the only thing I can promise you this, it won't be the same thing we're doing this week. At least it won't be in the same order. We may do some of the same stuff, so praise God. So maybe you'll come just so you'll figure out what they are going to do, praise the Lord, what we are going to do, amen? Okay, so this is Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 2. Ye shall not add unto the word which I command you, neither shall ye diminish aught from it, that you may keep the commandments of the Lord your God which I command you. Everybody say praise the Lord. All right, now let's go to Mark chapter 7, verses 8 and 9, Sheila. Mark 7, verses 8 and 9. For laying aside the commandment of God, ye hold the tradition of men, as the washing of pots and cups, and many other such like things ye do. And he said unto them, full well ye reject the commandment of God, that ye may keep your own tradition. Then verse 13. Making the word of God of none effect through your tradition, which ye have delivered, and many such like things do ye. So in Deuteronomy, we just read that you add nothing or you take nothing away from this. Everybody say praise the Lord. Praise Amen. But how many of you know the Pharisees and the Sadducees made up rules? They had this, but then they thought, well, if this is good, we'll just add a little something to it and make it even better, praise the Lord. And Jesus, what's interesting is he kept the law. If he had not kept the law, then we wouldn't be redeemed by his blood. He would have been a sinner as well. But he was not a sinner. He kept the law. But Jesus broke their rules. And he did it on a regular basis, and he did it and encouraged others to do it. Well, praise the Lord. So it'd be a good idea if we know what the Word says.
Exactly.
Praise the Lord. So we're not keeping a bunch of junk that we don't need to keep and doing a bunch of stuff we don't need to be doing so that we can do what it is we're supposed to be doing.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Because half of the things that the church, quote unquote, the religious world has people doing are just rules. They're not anything that's really valid as far as the Word of God is concerned. It's just something that my doctrine tells me we're supposed to do, or my denomination says we do this, and I'll tell you why. But first of all, I want to just give a couple of examples of how Jesus loved to upset the apple cart. That's what I love about him, I think, as much as anything else. The fact that he's my Savior, obviously, and Lord and King, but also I like his kind of give a care attitude sometimes when it comes to the way other people want to do stuff. Amen? So look at John chapter 5, Sheila, verses 8 through 10. John 5, verses 8 through 10. And I've just picked a couple of them here. We could spend half the morning here going through things that he did and said to show his real purpose. So Jesus said unto him, rise, take up your bed and walk. And immediately the man was made whole, took up his bed and walked, and on the same day was the Sabbath. How many of you know you're not supposed to carry a burden on the Sabbath? According to the Pharisees. Not according to the Word of God, according to the Pharisees. The Jews therefore said unto him, that was cured, it's the Sabbath day. It's not lawful for you to carry your bed. Now we know that cannot be true, or Jesus wouldn't have done it. Had he done it and this were true, he would have been a lawbreaker. Praise the Lord. So by that alone, without going back and looking at Deuteronomy and Leviticus and all that, you can just write it down. That was a bogus rule that had come through the Pharisaical religious way of doing things, and the Sadducees were as guilty of this as anybody. So There's number one, all right? Luke chapter 11, verses 37 through 39. Luke 11, 37 through 39. And when I read these things, I think about the stuff in the different churches I've been in my life and how much was just... And yet, it was made to be heaven and hell issues. It was taught as though you don't do this, you're going to bust hell wide open. Amen. So as he spake, a certain Pharisee besought him to dine with him, and he went in and sat down to meat. And when the Pharisee saw it, he marveled that he had not first washed before dinner. And the Lord said unto him, Now do ye Pharisees make clean the outside of the cup and the platter, but your inward part is full of ravening and wickedness. Verse 52. Woe unto you, lawyers, for you have taken away, I'd like to say that sometime, but this is about religious people, praise the Lord. Woe unto you, lawyers, for you have taken away the key of knowledge. You have entered not in yourselves, and them that were entering in you hindered. You won't go in, and you're not going to let them go in, praise the Lord. So here's the reality is they built fences around the Word of God. And they did it with their rules, with their traditions. Praise the Lord. And how have you know, to build a fence, they had to tear down a fence. Praise God. It's like religion is today. They built fences to keep the sheep in. Not for protection, but for greed, for selfish purposes. Amen. And, you know, I mentioned this Wednesday night, religion comes from a Latin word, legare, legare, which means to rebind or to be bound again. Yes. Now, that's kind of scary if you think about it. Now, that doesn't mean everything about religion is that way, but religion, by definition, right, you're delivered from bondage, from sin, yes, from hell, death, the grave, right? Yes. And delivered to what? To a different bondage. Yes. Praise the Lord. You're just leaving one bondage for a different bondage. Yeah. So you're escaping one set of lifestyles and standards and picking up another one. Yeah. Yeah. Praise the Lord. It's just another bondage. It's just another way of being manipulated. Amen. So look at John now, chapter 10, verses 7 through 11. John 10, verses 7 through 11. Now we'll get going here in a minute, but I want to make this clear. Praise the Lord. So then said Jesus unto them again, Verily, verily, I say unto you, I am the door of the sheep. All that ever came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not hear them. I am the door. By me, if any man enter in, he shall be saved, and shall go in and out and find pasture. The thief cometh not but to steal and to kill and to destroy. I'm come that they might have life, and that they might have it more abundantly. I am the good shepherd, and the good shepherd gives his life for the sheep. He isn't demanding your life. He's giving his life. Religion demands yours. Jesus offers his instead. Praise the Lord. So, know the truth, and you can get out of the sheep pen. Yes. Amen. You can get out. Okay, he says they come and they go from his. In other words, they're not in bondage. They have protection within the sheep pen, but they have the freedom to be able to move and go and live their lives and be natural, normal people supernaturally. See, the good shepherd, Jesus, is all about being, not doing. Right. Praise the Lord. He says things like, abide in me, yes, remain in me, yes, be with me, yes, follow me. Mm-hmm. So what Jesus wants, what he wants more than anything else, what he wants most, is not more of us in the sense of doing. He doesn't want more from you. He wants more of you.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Doing doesn't lead to being. How many of you have been in the doing mode of this thing at some point in your life? Didn't make you any better than what...
Right?
In fact, it made you more guilty and hypocritical because you knew, in fact, deep down inside, you, no matter how much you did it, really, you were still failing. You still weren't doing everything perfectly. So he's not interested in our doing. He's interested in our being. We are human beings, not human doers, praise the Lord, as someone else has said, praise the Lord. So instead of learning more about Jesus, we need to be focusing on learning to know Jesus. See, religion will give you all kinds of information about him, but it won't connect you with him. And that's what Jesus is interested in. That's what he's after, is the relationship. Not knowledge, but revelation. Praise the Lord. So look at John chapter 1, verse 1. See, the scripture says that the sheep know the shepherd. They hear his voice and they recognize his voice. Well, that tells me that there's a whole bunch of people in the world who really don't know the shepherd. Because the only voice they know is the religious voice.
Yeah.
Praise God. So in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Now, I just mentioned, I was talking to Sarah and Suzanne just briefly a moment ago, and Sally and I have talked about this over the last couple weeks. You know, people have a word for other people. How about a word for yourself?
Yeah.
I'm not being critical. I'm just saying, a lot of times, the Lord speaks to us, and we don't realize he's speaking to us.
Right.
He's not talking to you.
Right.
He's talking to me.
Right.
But sometimes it's easier for me to tell you he's talking to you than it is for me to listen to what he's saying to me.
Right.
I got a word for you. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. Look at John chapter 16, verses 13 to 15. And I'm not saying we should not prophesy. Obviously, I believe in prophetic utterances. I believe in prophetic words. I believe in sharing one with another. But I think we need just a little discernment and take the time to listen when God speaks. And maybe, just maybe, he's talking to me. Maybe he's not talking to you. Maybe he's not wanting me to tell Alvin this. Maybe he's wanting me to sit down and meditate on this and figure out what it is he's actually trying to say to me. Praise the Lord. Which also might mean why Alvin doesn't receive that word.
Sure, yeah.
Praise the Lord. Because it's not for him.
Right, yeah.
Right? Okay, so howbeit when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you into all truth. For he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak. And he will show you things to come. He shall glorify me, for he shall receive of mine, and shall show it unto you. All things that the Father hath are mine. Therefore said I, that he shall take of mine and shall show it unto you. All right? Now look at Luke chapter 12, verse 12. For the Holy Spirit shall teach you in the same hour what you ought to say. So the Holy Spirit speaks to you primarily about you.
Yes.
Somebody say praise the Lord. Amen. That may be a revelation. But the Holy Spirit is speaking to you about you.
Right.
About things about you that you don't know or won't admit.
Right. Right.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Because most people don't know themselves. Because we live in a world where we suppress everything and try to, you know, keep a positive attitude and, you know, positive confession. And there's nothing wrong with that. We should do that. As long as it's the Word of God.
Right.
But in doing that, sometimes we never really confront us.
Right.
And religion is really good about that because it focuses all the time on somebody else.
Right. Yeah.
Amen. The focus is always on somebody else's stuff and not mine.
Right.
And the more I focus on you, the less you have time to focus on me. Praise the Lord. So, you know, a lot of it's like accusations. A lot of times the people come in and immediately accuse, and it's because as long as you're defending yourself, you're not accusing them. Boom, you know. I'm just saying, that's kind of human nature. Get you on the defense, and then you're not really investigating my stuff. You're too busy covering up your own. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. So look at Romans chapter 8, verse 26 now. So most people either don't know themselves all that well, or they're not willing to admit the reality of what they do know. Now, this isn't a beat you up stuff. I mean, well, come on, we're saved by grace. It's all good. I'm just saying we need to get past some of this stuff in order to really operate in the Spirit. What we call the Spirit is just like what we're talking about here with church service. Just because you've got the Holy Ghost to speak in tongues, or because you believe in the gifts of the Spirit, doesn't mean that everything you're doing is spiritual. Even when it can look like it to someone who doesn't really know, who isn't discerning. In other words, you can be, you know, shouting and doing what your thing, but it doesn't necessarily mean God's involved in it at all. Okay? I'm just saying, we need to grow up and be honest with ourselves. This is not a bad thing. I'm just saying, see, that I have the mind of Christ, but I'm totally capable of operating with a carnal mind. Because whenever I deviate from the Word of God, I'm operating in a carnal mind, even though I'm this spirit being. See what I'm saying? So I can be full of the Holy Ghost, I can be laying hands on the sick, and at the same time, within a split second, I can be a complete jerk. And it's not and you know, some people from the outside would look at that and say, geez, what a hypocrite. No, what a human. But you just need to have the sense to discern between one and the other. I mean, it doesn't take away the spirituality of yourself. It just, to an unbeliever, it will be a problem. Because they'll say, they don't understand any of it anyway, so they just say, what a hypocrite. I don't want to be any part of that. Look, one minute they're doing this thing, and the next minute they're this. And no, they're human beings that are born again, that they're saved by grace, that are not perfect, but declared righteous because of what Jesus has done. So likewise, the Spirit also helps our infirmities, for we know not what we should pray. We don't know what we should pray for as we should, but the Spirit itself makes intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. So the Holy Spirit speaks to you about you. And since most people don't know themselves, He gives us intercessory prayer. Now, a lot of times we think intercessory prayer is always about praying, interceding on behalf of somebody else. This tells me, and that's not, I'm not saying that isn't true, but this tells me that half the time God is trying to get us to intercede for ourselves. Or the Holy Spirit to intercede for us, because we don't know what we're supposed to be praying. And so God's trying to get us to intercede. The Holy Spirit to intercede on our behalf, amen, so that we can get what God wants us to have and what we really need to have. We just don't know that's what we need. Hallelujah. Amen. It takes what is part of you that's not working right, that isn't discerning or comprehending or receiving or whatever it is, and then He prays through it. That's what the Holy Spirit does. That's the benefit of praying in tongues. Amen. That's the benefit of allowing the Spirit to lead you in prayer rather than you having an agenda. Sure. Nothing wrong with having a list of things that you're praying for and people that you're praying for. That's all good. But a lot, as I said, if you don't know you, how are you going to pray for you? Exactly. The Holy Spirit is the wheel in the middle of the wheel. Yes. Amen. He's the very core of you. He's the very center of who you are. He's the deepest part of you. And the realest part of you, if you really want to know the truth. So it'd be a good idea for that wheel that's in the middle of the wheel to just roll on. That's what I'd say. Just roll on. You take control. Because I can promise you this. I prayed about stuff in my life only to see a different result and be discouraged, only to then find out later that what I was praying for would have just screwed everything up had I known what was coming down the road. I thought it made perfect sense at the time in my mind, but if I had gotten what I'd been praying for, it would have made a mess forever.
Yeah.
So the Lord knows. Okay, Romans 8:27.
He that searcheth the hearts knoweth what is the mind of the Spirit, because he maketh intercession for the saints according to the will of God.
Yes.
So, you don't know what to pray. You think you know the what. The problem is you don't know the why.
Exactly.
That's the heart. Amen. The why is the heart. It goes deeper. You could say that it's like the difference between the conscious and the subconscious. You know, in your subconscious is every word of this Bible that you've ever read. It's there.
Yes.
It's in a memory bank. Praise the Lord.
Yes.
But it's not in your conscious. And God can bring that or quicken that to your conscience so you know what to say, you know what to pray, you know what to do in a certain situation. But if you're depending on just head knowledge,
yeah,
you're going to have problems.
Yeah.
Because your subconscious knows you pretty well.
Yeah.
It's your conscience that has a problem trying to figure out you.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. See, we don't always look to the heart. So we have to have the Holy Ghost. And we have to be willing to yield to him. And he'll take you deeper than the conscious. He'll take you deeper than the natural. He'll take you deeper than the carnal.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. You know, Jesus, the scripture says he is our high priest. And I mentioned, I think it was last Sunday, how when Jesus rode into town, into Jerusalem on the foal of an ass, a donkey. It's interesting, that donkey was one that had never been ridden, had never been worked. Amen. It was a foal. It had never done any labor. So the high priest, the Lamb of God, the high priest that offers the sacrifice itself, rode into town on grace. It's a beautiful picture of what Jesus was pointing everything to.
Yeah.
So he's our high priest. He's our Savior. He's our sacrifice. He is grace.
Yes.
And the Old Testament priests, they offered up sacrifices, but they couldn't enter into the presence of God. Only once a year the high priest would, but the priest during the normal time, they never entered into the presence of God. The sacrificial system was all outside, separate from the Holy of Holies. So the high priest would, once on the Day of Atonement, he would come in and sprinkle the mercy seat if the sacrifice had been accepted, because otherwise, if he goes in there fumbling around, they tie a rope around his leg and be able to drag him out when he drops dead in the presence of the Lord. That's the stories that the rabbis tell. So the Old Testament priests offered sacrifices, but they weren't able to enter the presence of God because those sacrifices were limited. They weren't the sacrifice, they were just a sacrifice. Amen? And here's my point. When you don't accept the finished work of Christ, there's no oneness with Christ. You'll just go through a religious cycle day in, day out, year in, and year out, without ever achieving the goal of that sacrifice or the purpose for which that sacrifice was given. To be one with God, to have access to God, to be connected to God. See, there's no real access to grace. If you try to do something to get that access outside of grace, it makes it about you.
Yeah.
It makes it about your effort.
Yes.
It makes it about your goodness.
Yes.
And you'll forever be separated.
Yes.
So you enter the holy place once the sacrifice is accepted. The holy place represents the presence of God, right? We all got that. So Jesus, the Word of God, is the only way to victory.
Yes.
The only way to oneness, the only way to the presence of God, the only way to the connection and the oneness of God is the only way to your revelation of Christ in you. Because religion is all about everything happening around you and externally. But this thing is all about what's going on in you. That Christ dwells in you. That the Holy Spirit lives in you. The Spirit of Christ dwells in you. Amen? It's about a personal revelation. It's about you and Jesus.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. And so we even take this thing to the point where, see, it's about grace and faith. It's about faith in grace. And we make it about faith in our faith. Praise the Lord. It's really not about that. If we have faith in the grace of God, we know that God's grace has brought us healing and deliverance and prosperity and salvation and all of that. So if we put our faith in that, not in whether or not I can get up enough faith to feel it when I'm praying for somebody for them to get healed. It's not about that. They've already been healed. I just put my faith, and they should put their faith in the grace of God because it's already done for them. That's how it's going to happen. That's how they're going to access grace and everything that it has purchased for us. Praise the Lord. Romans chapter 10, verses 5 through 11. These are scriptures we've been looking at here fairly often over the last month or two, but it's good that we get these things deep down inside of us to where we really have some understanding and some revelation. So it isn't just another word. For Moses describeth the righteousness which is of the law, that a man which doeth those things shall live by them. In other words, you've got to live righteously. But the righteousness which is of faith speaketh on this wise. Say not in thine heart, who shall ascend into heaven, that is to bring Christ down from above, or who shall descend into hell, who shall descend into the deep, that is to bring up Christ again from the dead. But what saith it? The word is nigh thee, even in thy mouth and in thy heart, that is the word of faith which we preach. That if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For the scripture saith, whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed. Praise the Lord. Amen. So I'm not trying to convince you because of what I believe that I've heard personally from God, but what God has said in his word to every one of us.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. His word is final.
Yes.
Praise God. So, you see, I'm really, and I don't mean to be, you know, rude or even arrogant in this sense, but I'm not really interested in whether you accept what I say or do. If I were, I'd be in therapy. Praise the Lord. Along with heavy prescription of some kind of antidepressant probably. But what I'm interested in is whether you believe the word of God and respond to it.
Yes.
Not because I said it, but because it's true.
Amen.
See, I'm not here for you. I'm here for Jesus, and because I'm here for Jesus, he makes me here for you.
Yes.
You understand? My first motive is not you. My first motive is do what Jesus is telling me to do. If I can, to the best of my ability.
Yeah.
And I don't always know exactly what that is. But see, if I'm here for you, y'all will just depress me. I mean, you'll bum me out. You won't respond when I think you ought to respond, and you will respond when I don't think you should have responded. And people get mad at things that I didn't mean for them to be mad at, and they'll laugh at the things I thought they should have really taken seriously. Because, see, I'm a mess, praise the Lord. And if I'm here to satisfy you, my life is this. Because I'm not sure everything I'm doing, and I know you're not sure about everything you're doing. So we're like this. So the Word of God and the Holy Spirit helps us to come together. But if my focus is not on him and my focus is on you or me,
right,
then I'm just a frustrated mess all the time. And you know that's true of you in your own life, no matter what it is. If you make it about other people and their opinions and their attitudes, they'll change with every mood that comes to them. It isn't just about you. They may have a bad day. How many have been, you know, stood in line at Walmart or Target or the grocery store or whatever, and somebody's just acting like a complete jerk, and you want to just turn around and say, do you realize how stupid you're acting?
Yeah.
Only to find out the next day you're doing the same thing in the parking lot. Because somebody got too close to your car, your truck, or whatever, you know? And you're thinking, whoa, back off here, you know? It's a vehicle.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord. So, here's my point. You can't be in Canaan eating manna. Somebody say amen to that. Praise the Lord. We're not under the old covenant.
That's right.
We're in a new relationship, and we need to operate from that new relationship, which is by the word of God.
Yes.
Man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God.
Yes.
Amen? So we need to act on his word so that you won't be disappointed, or as we read just a moment ago, ashamed.
Right. Amen.
Acting on your feelings or your own word is going to lead to some disappointment.
Right.
And shame, praise the Lord.
Yep.
Hebrews chapter 5, verses 12 through 14, Sheila. Hebrews 5, 12 through 14. So, when for the time ye ought to be teachers, ye have need that one teach you again, which be the first principles of the oracles of God. And become such as have need of milk and not of strong meat. For everyone that useth milk is unskillful in the word of righteousness, for he is a babe. But strong meat belongs to them that are full age, even those who by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. The only way you can do that is right here, by the word of God. Because your mind will convince you that some of the stuff you do is justified. Mine does. Amen. Until I have a moment of reality,
yeah.
And I'm sitting and meditating a little bit, and all of a sudden, whoa, maybe that wasn't such a bright idea.
Yeah.
Maybe I should have thought a little bit before I engaged this thing. Praise the Lord. We need to operate by the Spirit, the mind of the Spirit. Praise the Lord. So you act on his word, and you won't be ashamed. Praise the Lord. Now, look, this word isn't true because it worked for you. It's true because it's the word of God. This word isn't untrue because it didn't work for you. It's still true because it's the word of God. Praise the Lord. You can't add anything to the finished work of Christ, the word of God. You can only act on it. You can only agree with that reality of it. So just make it about him. Make it about the word. You're not just forgiven. You have a completely new nature. You are a new creation. Amen? In Christ Jesus, you are something totally new. A whole new species of humanity. A spiritually alive person. Praise the Lord. He took sin. He took sickness. He took the curse. And he came back victorious. Amen.
Yes.
He came back over death, hell, and the grave.
Yes.
Victorious.
Yes.
He defeated it all. Amen.
Yes.
All right. Look at 1 John chapter 3, verses 1 through 3. 1 John 3, 1 through 3. That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, and our hands have handled of the word of life, for the life was manifested. We have seen it and bear witness and show it unto you, that eternal life which was with the Father was manifested unto us. That's not what I want. I want 1 John. I'm sorry, Sheila. I don't believe it is. 1 John 3, verses 1 through 3.
Sorry,
Behold, what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. Therefore the world knoweth us not, because it knew him not. Beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it does not yet appear what we shall be, but we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. And every man that has this hope in him purifieth himself, even as he is pure. Bestowed, not earned. Sons of God, bestowed upon us. Not because of something we did, but because of something he gave. It has been bestowed. It has been given freely to you. Praise the Lord. All right, now I want to just switch gears just a little bit here and go to Exodus chapter 21, verses 5 and 6. I mean, it's still in the context. I go different directions here, but hopefully it's still about the same thing. It is to me, and if it's not for you, you can talk to me about it later. Praise the Lord. Anyway, Exodus 21, verses 5 and 6. And if the servant shall plainly say, I love my master, my wife, and my children, I will not go out free. Then his master shall bring him unto the judges. He shall also bring him to the door or under the doorpost, and his master shall bore his ear through with an awl, and he shall serve him forever. So the slave has served his time, and he's supposed to be set free. But he doesn't want to be set free. Right? All right, look at Deuteronomy chapter 15. It gives a little clearer picture. Deuteronomy 15, verses 12 through 17. Now, I'm just thinking, just put yourself in this position. You've been a slave to sin. You've been in bondage to your own humanity, right? And Jesus comes along. Now, the reality is these people were indentured servants, and they were slaves for 6 years. And the seventh year, they were sent free. Not only were they set free, they were given all kinds of gifts and everything else to go. So it's telling me this. Jesus sets us free, but we want Jesus more than we want what we think is freedom or the stuff, right? The stuff you'll get if you make it about, that's why seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and this stuff gets taken care of, right? All right, so now look. If thy brother, a Hebrew man or a Hebrew woman, be sold unto thee and serve thee 6 years, then in the seventh year thou shalt let him go free. How many seventh years? A year of rest. 7 days, God, 6 days God created, 7 days rest. It's a God, the fullness of God. Amen? So if your brother, okay, the seventh year, you'll let him go free from thee. And when thou sendest him out free from thee, thou shalt not let him go away empty. Thou shalt furnish him liberally out of thy flock, out of thy floor, out of thy winepress, of that wherewith the Lord thy God hath blessed thee, thou shalt give unto him. And thou shalt remember that thou wast a bondman in the land of Egypt, and that the Lord thy God redeemed thee. So you see the connection here in terms of salvation. Therefore, I command thee this thing today. And it shall be, if he says unto thee, I will not go away from thee, because he loveth thee and your house, because he is well with you, or happy in this situation, then you'll take it all and thrust it through his ear unto the door, and he shall be thy servant forever, and also unto thy maidservant thou shalt do likewise. So here's an indentured guy in servitude, and he serves for 6 years, and in the seventh year he's set free. If the servant doesn't want to be freed, he's taken a lot, and the master doesn't want to free him, or the master wants to keep him. They go to the gate of the city, the big wooden gate, before the elders. Amen. And the servant says, I'm going to serve him, not me. Somebody say, praise the Lord. You know where it's going, right? So I want to serve him, not me. I want his purpose, not my purpose. Praise the Lord. Now, it's almost like what the prodigal says, because he understands this law. The prodigal is saying, look, I'll be a servant. I'll be an indentured servant. Yeah. It's better than, being out here in the world and getting nothing, because if I come back and connect, then I can be a part of I can have a relationship again. And the father won't hear of it, because he's saying, you're still my son. We're not even going to talk servanthood here. Right?
But you see what's going on here. The master and the servant then go before the elders of the city. They stand before the gate. And the master says, "This is my servant." He who was servant is now family. Amen. Listen to what I'm saying. And I'm going to back him completely. He's refused all these goods that I was demanded to give him if I set him free.
Right.
He won't take them. He loves me.
Right.
And I love him.
Right.
So he's not a servant anymore. He's now part of my family.
Glory.
Amen? And he said, "I'll back him completely like I would anybody in my family."
Yes.
Amen? If he speaks, it's as if I'm speaking. He's saying this before the elders. That's the reason for being there at the city gate before all the elders. It's a law. It's being written down. It's being confessed as the reality for this individual.
Yes.
And he gives him a ring, a gold ring, which is like the power of attorney. It's just like a signet ring. It says, "I'm his agent. I'm his spokesman.
Yes.
I'm him in absentia." Praise the Lord. So he takes an awl, the master does, and runs the guy up against the city gates and runs the awl through his ear, and blood rushes out. He's making a blood covenant.
Yes, he is.
And he's doing it before the whole city.
Yeah.
And then he takes the gold ring and puts it in his ear so that everywhere he goes, everybody sees this is him.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
And whatever he says, I'm saying.
Uh-huh.
Whatever he does, I'm doing.
Yes.
What did Jesus say? I only say what I hear my Father say. I only do what I see my Father do. I and my Father are one.
Jesus.
Praise the Lord. I am his representation. Praise God.
Yes.
All right. 1 John chapter 4, verse 17. Herein is our love made perfect, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. Praise the Lord. We have been made one with Christ by the shed blood, by the blood covenant that he made with himself. We have become family. We have become one with him. We become spokesmen. What we say, he says, I'll back it up. What you bind on earth, I'll bind in heaven. Whatever you bind, whatever you loose, I'll loose. Praise the Lord. You're speaking for me.
Right.
Praise God. As Jesus is, as he is, so are we in this world. Praise God. When you confess Christ as Savior, however that transpired in your life, because all of us came in a different way, but the result is the same, and initially God looked at it the same way. Right? I don't know what your prayer was, but you were saying, I believe that you died for me and that you rose again and that my sins have been redeemed because of the shed blood that you placed, amen, on my behalf, amen, as my sacrificial lamb. So when you confess Christ as Savior, Master, remember that old song? Savior, Master, right? Praise the Lord, amen. I know it didn't sound like that, I'm just saying. But when you did that, when you prayed that, when you confessed that, what did God do? I mean, did God say, let me think about Don Wyckoff. Let me think about this for a little bit. I'm not sure how I should respond. No! Today is the day of salvation. The moment you prayed that, you were saved. You were one with Christ. You became connected. You became family.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. You were saved from hell.
Yes.
Saved from sickness.
Yes.
From poverty.
Yes.
From spiritual death. The entire curse of the law.
Yes.
So sickness comes. Or stick your own adjective in here. Poverty, whatever it might be. It doesn't matter. Whatever the problem. It comes to you and you confess The Word of God. By His stripes I'm healed. He became poor that I might become rich. Amen. He rejoices in the prosperity of His servants.
Yes.
Does God say, gee, I'm not sure about that? Let me think about this for a little while. Today is the day of salvation. There's no debate in heaven. There's no God questioning this person's words. He's speaking for me.
Yes.
Hallelujah. It's a done thing. It's already done. And we have this say it and look off to the future somewhere and maybe it'll happen. No, just like you got saved the moment you believed, you confessed. Hallelujah, your faith wasn't perfect unless you're way different than most people. You were in a quandary about this whole thing. It was more as much hope as it was faith. So we're doing the same thing when we pray for healing, when we pray for prosperity, when we pray for breakthrough in whatever the area it might be. Yes. Believe that when I said it,
yes,
He did it. Praise the Lord. It's accomplished. Amen. It is finished because as He is,
yes,
so am I in this world. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Give the Lord a hand. Hallelujah. Praise God. All right, let's finish up. Last scripture here, Deuteronomy. We'll go back to Deuteronomy chapter 4, and I want to read verses 4 through 7, Sheila. Deuteronomy 4, verses 4 through 7. See, God wants to do a new thing, and for God to do a new thing, we got to start operating in a new way. Hallelujah. We got to start, even though we have known this, to know it is one thing. To know it about you is a whole other thing. This is about you. Ye that did cleave unto the Lord your God are alive, every one of you this day. Behold, I have taught you statutes and judgments, even as the Lord my God commanded me, that you should do so in the land whither you go to possess it. Keep therefore and do them, for this is your wisdom and your understanding in the sight of the nations, which shall hear of these statutes and say, surely this great nation is a wise and understanding people. For what nation is there so great who hath God so nigh unto them, as the Lord our God is in all things that we call upon Him for? In other words, that was the Jews, but we know those are all types and shadows and pointing to a greater reality under the new covenant. We are supposed to live this way so that the unbeliever looks at us and goes, man, oh man, look what God's doing. That, whatever it is that they've got, we need to get some of that, because you cannot deny their closeness to God is changing their life. It's changing everything about them. They're prospering. They're healed. There's miraculous things going on in their life. And it's not because of them. It's because of their closeness, their connection with God Almighty. Amen. And if you know that as He is, so are you in this world, it will change your life and it'll change the life of everybody you come into contact with. They cannot deny the presence of God in your life. Give Him a hand this morning. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Amen. I want us to go to the Lord in prayer now, and I'm going to give you an opportunity to share your prayer request, but before we do that, I'm going to give you mine. Amen. And I've got two nephews that have been diagnosed with cancer, serious stuff. I won't go into all the negativity about it. Just suffice it to say it's cancer. And a brother, David, who's doing well, but he's still on the medication for this pre-blood cancer. And then I just talked to my sister-in-law, his wife, two days ago, I guess, and she got a biopsy back, and she has breast cancer. It's in very early stages, but she has it nevertheless. So I'd like couple of guys, well, let's just do it this way. I want us to confess their healing. Now, they're believers, but again, they don't. In fact, I told my brother, I was talking to him the other night, I said, look, here's the deal. I know we don't agree doctrinally about multiple things, but I said, Jesus never said we ever would. He just said that we would all come to the unity of the faith, not doctrines. As long as there's
different people on this planet, we're going to have different doctrines. But we can come in the unity of the faith, and that is that Jesus Christ is the answer to every issue, every situation, and every circumstance, regardless of our doctrines, regardless of our denominational differences. Amen. And so, and of course, he agreed with me. So God doesn't have a problem getting from this church to a Lutheran church or a Baptist church or a synagogue, or, you know, I mean, he can, wherever there's people believing in his grace, putting faith in his grace, God responds. So that's what I want us to do for them. I want us to believe that by his stripes they were healed. His goodness and his grace has provided everything that they have need of. And we're just going to put our faith in that. Not in your faith. You may think, I don't know, man, that's a serious thing. But it doesn't matter. It can be a common cold. It can be staged, whatever, 50, cancer. Nothing's impossible for God. It's just big stuff for us. It's not big stuff for God. So let's just have faith in grace that his reality will become their reality. Amen. All right, with that, now I'd like to take any other requests. Roberto, I know Kelly's. Amen. That the desired result comes to pass. Praise the Lord. Amen. Anybody else? Yes, Carol. Okay, we're gonna pray, and you know, I think we prayed for you Wednesday night, but we're gonna confess over you again. God heard us the first time, so we're just gonna rebuke the pain and declare that God's word is the final word.
Yes.
Amen. And if you can, try to, I'm not saying to be in denial, I'm just saying don't let the symptoms override the truth.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. I know that's easier said than done, but that's why it's called faith. Praise the Lord. You just have to continue to confess God's word against this, because the enemy will try to keep coming in against you. Okay. Yes, ma'am.
My children and my grandchildren, they were raised in the way they should go, so when they grow old, they shall not depart from
them. Amen. That's a good word from the Lord, and he'll stand on it.
I have grandchildren, and my children need to walk the Lord.
Amen.
They need to go back to where they were raised.
Praise the Lord. We'll believe with you for that. We know that's the will of God. Amen. And if it's his will, we know he hears us.
Yes.
And if he hears us, we know we have our petition. Amen. So it's a done deal. We're going to celebrate all of this. As soon as we get through with prayer, we're going to go into worship, and we're going to have worship and thanksgiving for what God is doing as a result of the prayer right here today. Amen. Yes, Jody.
Me and my brother Jason have two aunts that have been diagnosed with cancer. One's progressed a little heavier, the other one's just had a
Amen. Okay, Dan?
Yeah. I'd like to thank everybody for my prayers for my foot. It went to the doctor last week. It looks awesome.
He said,
I go Friday and get my stitches out. So thank you very much.
Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Amen.
Yes.
Yes.
And
amen.
Faith is in the Lord Jesus, and it's going to be good.
Amen.
Yes. That is right.
It is impossible for him not to be.
Amen.
We all proclaim it.
Yes.
I do. Jesus does.
Yes.
Nothing but healing.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Dan. Anyone else? Yes. Amen. Amen. We're just going to pray. God knows exactly what you need. I'm just, in my heart, I'm thinking, Lord, give him strength, encouragement, peace, and let that joy just come up inside of them so that you can focus on, I've lost a sister and a brother, and so that you can focus on the good times you had together and what's to come in the future. Amen. But God knows exactly what to do in this situation. That's why sometimes it's best for us to just leave it in God's hands. Pray and just trust the Lord to do, you know, what really needs to be, because they got their stuff, and God knows perfectly what to give them in that situation. So that's the way we're going to pray. Anybody else? Tim. Right.
Because when God's in it, we're all big, because he turns things around. We had to take the car to get a service yesterday, and one of the things that the guy said, you know, walked in there, and I was planning on paying, because the last time the guy said that was the last free one, to walk the car down there. So I said, well, you know, we're planning on paying on it. And then he said, no, you know, this was on us too. So
Yeah, amen. Yeah. Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. Yes, Suzanne. Amen. Praise the Lord. Anybody else? All right, let's stand and go to the Lord in prayer right now. Now, I know we don't remember every word that was said by everybody. The good news is God does. So we're praying in faith for every one of these needs, for every one of these situations. We're trusting God because He knows. He knew the prayer you were going to ask for prayer before you did. Amen. In fact, He inspired you to ask for it so that He can do something on your behalf. Amen? So we're going to put our faith in the grace of God. Not in our efforts, not in our worthiness, not in the people that we're praying for His worthiness, but in the goodness and the grace and the love of God that wants to bring blessing and deliverance and breakthrough into every one of these people's lives. So, Father, we just come to You right now in total confidence of Your goodness and Your grace. And we release our faith in that grace right now. That, Lord, nothing is impossible with You. You can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. And we put our faith in that right now. We know Your heart for the lost, for the broken, for the hurting, for the grieving. We know Your love for man. You gave Your life because You so loved this world. And we're asking this morning, Lord, for the manifestation of that reality in each one of these people's lives. Show Yourself mighty on their behalf. Be more real to them than You've ever been in their lives before. Make it an intimate contact with each and every one of them. Let them know that this was their God that has touched them, who loves them, who gave Himself for them. Hallelujah, Lord. You receive all the glory, all the praise, and all the blessing because You alone are worthy. You are a great and a mighty God. There's none like You, Lord. And we praise You this morning for Your mighty acts and for Your excellent greatness. Hallelujah. Amen. Let's worship the Lord this morning and thank Him for what He's doing right now.
Choose who.